Unfortunately, Tom Antonelli is unable to join us this evening. So speaking on tonight's panel will be Brenna Ian and Zahar Nerzadeh. Moderated by Hodakawa, Director of Policy and Advocacy on the Muslim Public Affairs Council. Bernadette is a career foreign service officer and who most recently served as Special Assistant to the President on National Security for National Security Affairs and spokesperson for the White House National Security Council. Zahar serves as the Director of the National Security Council at the White House. Prior to joining the NSC in 2014, she served as a Foreign Affairs Officer at the State Department. Sahara and Hoda are both GW alums, so we're extremely excited to welcome both them and Bernadette back to campus to discuss one of President Obama's most significant foreign policy achievements. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. Thank you, Sahara, for joining us tonight. I think that this is an incredibly timely event, and I can speak on behalf of the audience when we say that we're really excited to talk about what went down when we were on the curriculum, what's continuing to happen, how we as young and passionate people who are living, or blessed enough to be living here in the nation's capital, what can we do to support or really amplify the voices around this Iran nuclear deal? So I'm really excited to get into the nitty-gritty of the Iran nuclear deal and how your roles were really valued. So before I start, I just want to sort of look at this deal from a 30,000-foot bird's eye view. Where was President Obama's vision on this Iran nuclear deal? Where have we come from just a few years ago, this was an idea, to having it being passed, hopefully, and be done with the conversations and be done with the back and forth with Congress. Where have you gone? What have been the struggles that you all have had to overcome in order to get to where we are today?
I will actually turn it over to Sahar to start, since she's been engaged with the negotiations in a different manner than I have, and then I'll jump in after she goes a little bit through sort of the nuclear progression and the fundamentals of the technical aspects of the conference.
Sure. Yeah. So I guess maybe I'll take a step back even further than the past couple of years since the president came into office and these nuclear negotiations have been taking place. With a little bit of a background on Iran's nuclear program, nuclear negotiations even before President Obama came into office. So most of you might know, maybe some of you don't know, that Iran's nuclear program started back in the 1950s and 60s under the Shah. Back then with American assistance, and then was stopped in 1979 with the Islamic Revolution. Iran's leaders decided to kind of curtail their nuclear activities temporarily, but then revamped them in the 1980s after the Iran-Iraq War started. And dating back to 1995, we started basically passing new sanctions against Iran to further pressure them, both for their support for terrorism at the time, but also because we were basically fearful that they were pursuing WMD back then. And so we know now, and some of you may have read in kind of unclassified national intelligence assessments that in the 1990s and early 2000s, Iranian military entities were pursuing a nuclear weapons program. And so in 2002, the world kind of discovered these undeclared nuclear sites in Iran, Natanz in Iraq. They probably sound very familiar right now, but at the time they were new discoveries. And so under international scrutiny and pressure, we saw Iran halt its nuclear program in 2003. That continues to be our assessment to today. But it continued its nuclear program and continued the pursuit of enrichment. And so 2003, 2005, our European partners started engaging with Iran. The French, the UK, and our German counterparts. And they came to a few arrangements with Iran, but nothing really stuck. And so Iran continued to kind of ramp up its program, and the international community continued to pressure Iran through UN Security Council resolutions, through increased sanctions, pressure, diplomatic pressure. And as Iran continued to kind of defy the international community, we were able to kind of start building a bit of a coalition with our partners to basically pressure Iran to address the international community's concerns. In 2006, Iran declared that they had installed 164 centrifuges. So basically they had achieved their ability to enrich. By the time President Obama took office, Iran had about 5,000 such refugees. But when he entered office, he made clear that he was willing to resolve this issue diplomatically if Tehran's leaders approached the talks seriously. And when they didn't, ultimately, we had rounds of negotiations in 2009, 2010, 2011. We continued to ramp up the pressure, and our partners joined us. It didn't help that at the time it was the former president Ahmadinejad who had a very troublesome rhetoric on the international scene, so that helped galvanize further international support to pressure Iran. And it didn't help that Iran had yet another concealed nuclear facility at Fordo, which President Obama uncovered in 2009. And so we kind of reached a bit of a breakthrough in 2013, and that backdrop was pretty much unprecedented sanctions pressure. In 2011, 2012, we instituted oil sanctions, financial sanctions that had a detrimental impact on Iran's economy. And in 2013, you had the internal kind of political scene shaping up for the presidential elections. Now, this was the first presidential election that Iran had since 2009. And you guys are very young, but hopefully you remember kind of this green movement that took place in 2009. So again, the Iranian people took to the polls in 2013, and thanks to some splits amongst the more conservative elements who ran that election, Rouhani was elected on a platform to basically improve Iran's relations with the international community, solve the nuclear issue diplomatically, and gain sanctions relief. And so once President Rouhani came to office, we had the UN General Assembly in New York in the fall of 2013. And that was the first time that we had had incredibly high-level engagement with the Iranian government since the 1979 revolution. I know now we're all kind of desensitized to Iranian Foreign Minister Zarif sitting down with Secretary of State John Kerry, but at the time when it happened, it was a huge breakthrough. And of course, we had the phone call between President Obama and President Rouhani. That was the first phone call between an Iranian and American president since 1979. And so we saw this new nuclear negotiating team come in. And they came in very serious. The negotiations were conducted in English for the first time, and it sounds like maybe that's a small matter, but it helps reduce kind of the misunderstandings in the room, reduces the amount of time it takes to actually negotiate. And we could tell that, you know, there was a serious chance for us to solve this issue diplomatically. And so we reached this interim deal in November 2013, which started getting implemented in January 2014, and that halted and froze Iran's program in key areas, rolled it back in some other key respects, and allowed us the time and space for negotiations. Now, in the past, people had been concerned that Iran had been using the cover of negotiations to advance its program. Under the JPOA, we were able to keep the program frozen, which gave us the time and space to negotiate. Now, of course, nobody knew exactly how much time and space we needed to negotiate this deal. You probably all saw in the news the deadlines that were set and then extended. But over time, each time we extended the talks, we had made progress. But ultimately, you know, President Obama and I, our entire team, were determined on getting this right, you know, down to every detail. No detail was too small. And ultimately, our Secretary of Energy engaged in the talks with his Iranian counterpart, the head of Iran's Atomic Energy Organization, Saleh, and they were able to hash out the technical details. And at a higher level, and we're able to really sit down and talk science. They both actually are MIT alum. They didn't know each other back when they were both at MIT, but at least they both kind of had those credentials and were able to hash it out. And so it took time for us to get this deal, but ultimately we did, and we feel very good about it. We feel that it achieves all of the core objectives that we kind of set out to achieve as part of this process and do it diplomatically. I'm sure you guys have kind of heard the various spiels about what this deal does, but ultimately, it permanently prohibits Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon. That is what this deal does, and that is what we set out to do. It cuts off Iran's pathways through uranium enrichment at Natanz and Fordo, through the plutonium path at its Arak heavy water reactor. It's the best hedge we've had against a covert pathway. So Iran obviously does not have a good track record for complying with its nuclear obligations, and so this deal sets out the most extensive, most comprehensive verification and transparency regime that's ever been negotiated in the nuclear context. And so, you know, that was an incredibly important priority for President Obama and our entire team to basically have all of those elements included in the deal. And hence, you know, for those of you who have actually looked at the text, it's 159 pages. Annex 1, the nuclear annex, is extremely long and technical, but like I said, no detail was too small to kind of ensure that this is a long, verifiable, comprehensive deal. And so I hope that kind of gives a good history in terms of how we got here.
So on the public side, when people like Sahar were engaged in the negotiations, we had the task of basically identifying what the different audiences were that we would have to sort of engage with. But going back sort of as Sahar did, when the president first decided to open these negotiations, he used two main negotiators. One was Bill Burns, who was the Deputy Secretary of State at the State Department. The other was Jake Sullivan, who at the time was the Deputy Chief of Staff to Secretary Clinton and subsequently became the National Security Advisor to the Vice President of the White House. So at the time, when the talks were secret, you know, these guys would fly off to Oman, and we would sit down and say, okay, if someone sees you over there, someone realizes that you've gone overseas, how are we going to explain this to the public, to our allies, to the Hill? Because all of these talks at the time were going on under the cover of secrecy. And the reason that we did that is because we were testing a proposition, right? The Iranians had indicated a willingness to negotiate, but as Sahar said, they did not have a particularly good track record on trustworthiness. We were coming off of Ahmadinejad, a president who certainly did not inspire any confidence in a change in attitude of the regime. Rouhani was a very untested proposition. Certainly there was a lot of hope, both inside Iran and outside of Iran around the world, that he would be a more moderate president, but it was unproven at the time. So we spent a lot of time working on contingency guidance, how we would explain this if it became public and it wasn't on our terms. We always like to control the message, obviously, that's to our advantage. And much to our surprise, the secrecy held. The other thing that we had to deal with, both on the messaging side and on the diplomatic side, is how we would explain this to the P5 plus one partners, because the P5 plus one track of diplomacy, which Under Secretary Sherman was undertaking, was a parallel track. So we always knew, ultimately, that the talks that we were having bilaterally with the Iranians would feed into the international negotiations being held by the broad P5 plus one. So there was a lot of work behind the scenes on how we merged those two. How do you approach those partners and explain to them that we've been having these talks with the Iranians, that we, you know, were doing this in secret, but it wasn't sort of bypassing the international system, that we fully expected to integrate this into the system. So all of that was work that was going on behind the scenes. While the negotiations were ongoing and as parts of the teams were negotiating in the context of the P5 plus one. Once the talks obviously became public, as Sahar said, we had to figure out how we were going to message not only the deal, we had to figure out how we were going to work with Congress, we had to figure out how we were going to work with P5 plus one international partners, we had to figure out how we were going to work with the Israelis, who obviously had very strong feelings, how we were going to work with Gulf partners and others in the broader Middle East who also were somewhat skittish and had concerns given Iran's history in the region. So there was a lot sort of on the messaging side that we had to dovetail, knowing that whoever controlled the message obviously would ultimately play a large role in the success or failure of the talks. And that comes into play a little bit later when we talk about Congress and the vote and how we ultimately sold the deal and pushed it through.
So Sahar, Bernadette mentioned sort of the mistrust and distrust of our relationship with the Iranians for over 30 years now. How did that play into the negotiations, practically speaking? How was the team able to get over that? And I mean, I'm sure that played as a big obstacle to the negotiating team. Can you just talk a little bit about that?
Sure, thanks. That's a great question. You know, it's interesting. I always remember this quote from Ambassador John Limbert. He's one of the former hostages in Iran, and he's also a great diplomat, now teaches over at the Naval Academy. He basically said that whenever we sit down with the Iranians in the room, we're always wrestling the ghosts of the past, of our history. I think that was absolutely true in these talks as well, and ultimately kind of influenced the outcome, which is that this is a deal that's it's really not based on trust, because there's a lack of trust on our side, but also on the Iranian side. We share a difficult history with them. And so this is based on verification, both for the Iranian side, you know, every detail is written in the agreement, and for our side, every detail is written in the agreement. But of course, you face that, you know, in the room, even if it goes unspoken at times. And I think the folks who spent the most time in the room can kind of speak to it a bit, but it absolutely played a role, but it speaks to the significance of the
this deal that we were even able to overcome that and achieve this diplomatic solution despite that difficult history, despite, you know, decades of mistrust and animosity.
And Brenda, you also mentioned our relationship with allies, either in the Gulf or our relationship with Israel. How did that play into you having to craft messages or messaging around the Iran deal, given that, you know, two of our closest allies were spending a lot of money trying to see the depth of the deal?
So this.
This will be an interesting case study someday, I think. It was different in a lot of respects, so both on the diplomatic side, on the messaging side, on the congressional engagement side. I think this was a challenge because you had essentially our closest ally in the region, Israel, with whom we share, it's been said many times, an unshakable bond, a lot of shared cultural traditions, values, a lot of the same sort of policy incentives. And for the first time you saw, not the first time, but the first time in very recent memory and in such a public way, such a public spat, which I think was very uncomfortable for both sides. And it was a very difficult line that we had to walk because the president felt very, very strongly that this deal was in the best interest of the United States of America. He also felt very strongly that this deal was in the best interest of Israel's national security, the security of the Israeli people, and would ultimately be in the best interest of the security of our allies in the broader Middle East, specifically the Gulf, which is sort of the consortium of countries that had the broader concerns on the Arab side. So, you know, there's a lot of behind-the-scenes work that goes into reassuring those allies. There's a lot of public work that goes into it. You can examine all of the statements that we would make, the rhetoric of every call readout, of every meeting that the president had with Prime Minister Netanyahu, with the leaders of those countries. Every single word was nuanced, was negotiated, was debated before it was put out. I don't think I can recall another scenario where we ever had to walk such a fine line. In the messaging, the public messaging that we had to do to help reassure some of those allies, and also sort of the added challenge of reassuring members of Congress who felt very strongly bound to some of those other parties, in particular Israel, to do everything we could to reassure them that the concerns that they had about Israel's security and the security of friends in the Gulf was going to be addressed. So it was a fine line to walk. I like to think that we managed it as best we could, and I think it's the hope of everyone in the administration that now that the deal has survived the votes in Congress, that we can sort of put the very public bickering aside, and as we focus on implementation, go back to sort of the very strong sharing of information and collaboration, and remembering that we're all on the same side, and that is the side that is determined to prevent Iran from acquiring a nuclear weapon, determined to verify all the agreements that Iran is now a party to, and ensuring that if there is any attempt to violate those agreements, that we use sort of the joint combined powers and influence that we have to prevent that from happening.
So speaking of case studies, I think another aspect to the Iran nuclear deal that we can look at, probably even now, is engagement with Congress and the conversations that were going on Capitol Hill, and even the conversations that eventually trickled down to the UN and then became the national conversation. How were you, and so for both of you, how did you guys navigate that very tricky path in order to ensure that people's concerns were allayed, or you know, crafting messages and you know, this narrative that this is good for America, this is good for our national interest. How was that dealing with Congress?
I can speak to the substance a little bit, and then maybe I'll turn it over to Bernd to talk about, you know, some of the messaging vis-a-vis Congress. On the substance, I mean, you know, this was one of the most important national security debates we've had since the Iraq War. And so, understandably, you know, members of Congress had, you know, very serious questions about what was actually achieved. Obviously, there had been a lot of rhetoric leading up to the deal. We kept the negotiations very much behind closed doors, but people who you know, wrote various stories and claimed to know what was happening inside the negotiating room tended to kind of influence how members of Congress thought about what we were actually negotiating, which actually didn't end up being true in the end. But of course, we couldn't say that at the time because, you know, we didn't want to unsettle negotiations. So, you know, on the substance, I mean, since the deal was reached, we really have spent the past couple of months answering all the various questions, whether they have to do with technical details and involving some of our foremost nuclear scientists, whether it's Secretary Moniz or folks from our national labs, so that folks can actually understand the science behind the deal, because there's a tremendous amount of science behind the deal. Or talking about the modalities for the dispute resolution processes going forward, what kind of access will we have to Iran's nuclear facilities, all the kind of various facts that we negotiated in the 159-page document, but being able to sit down and kind of explain that to members of Congress. And ultimately, I think that the more they got to know about the deal, the more support we saw from members of Congress, and I think that ultimately led to kind of what we consider, a good step in terms of us being able to move forward with implementation of the deal once the review period is over.
I think on the public side, what we tried to do is somewhat similar, was to educate the public about the facts of the deal, but what you find when you undertake a strategy like that is, surprise, surprise, most Americans are not nuclear scientists. When you start talking about centrifuges and enrichment and plutonium pathways to a bomb, people's eyes sort of cloud over, people don't really understand what that means. So we sort of try and raise it up a level. When you look at polling, there were a couple things that we saw that people identified with or that resonated with people. One was, across the board, it was pretty hard to find any American who supported the use of military action as a resolution to the Iranian nuclear question. Right? So that was a theme that you saw us pull on very early on, and it made a lot of people in Congress very uncomfortable, including a number of Democrats, right, who at the time were very conflicted, because there were a lot of different positions and a lot of people sort of pushing them to sort of vote or come out in favor of the deal or oppose the deal. So it resonated with the public, but it also stirred up a bit of a hornet's nest. There were a lot of senators and congressmen who came out after some of those statements were made and said, the White House is painting a false picture. It's not a question of this diplomatic deal or war. It's disingenuous of them to say so. So where we went from there was a second argument that I think was really effective for us after the choice between war or diplomacy, and that was, okay, so you're saying that it's not a choice between war or diplomacy. What is the alternative to this deal? And it was crickets. You couldn't hear anyone articulate a practical, implementable alternative to this deal. And that went on for some time, and I think culminated when Prime Minister Netanyahu to give his much volleyball speech to Congress. And I remember all of us sitting there listening to it in the West Wing of the White House, where my office was at the time, and we just thought, well, that's a lot of rhetoric, and he makes some very stirring points, but there was no credible alternative laid out to the deal. So we were able to sort of use that again and say, we challenge anybody who says that they don't want Iran to have a nuclear weapon to tell us a better way than this deal that does not involve military action, and nobody was able to do that. And so that resonated very well with the public as well. Some people came out and said, you know what, you should just abandon this deal and you should implement additional sanctions. And if you put additional sanctions on Iran and you ratchet up the pressure, you'll be able to prevent them from having a deal and we don't have to go to war. And we just keep on this path that's been so successful. But there were a lot of problems with that. And probably the most beneficial for us was we, the United States government, didn't have to do the heavy lifting on that argument because all of our allies around the world, starting with the Europeans, came out and said, you people are out of your mind. We have been taking a hit on our economies to implement these sanctions for years. And what did the Americans always say was the point of the sanctions? To force Iran to the negotiating table. Now that Iran is at the negotiating table, is negotiating seriously, you're going to tell us you're not going to listen to them, you're going to pull out of the deal, and you expect us to pay the financial cost of that? There's no way that's going to happen. So the argument then became America would suffer a loss in prestige, we would suffer a loss in credibility, and we would lose the support of the allies, which was one part of the argument, and the other one was the international sanctions regime would collapse. So you'd sort of have the adverse effect of not only getting Iran to halt their program, but the collapse of the sanctions that were so punchy on Iran would essentially be lifted anyway because the international community would refuse to sort of hold them up if we walked away from the table. And I think, to hear us make that argument, it's sort of like, okay, they're just kind of saying that. But when you have foreign ministers from the UK, from France, from Germany, from Russia going out and saying that,
when you have countries like Japan, India, China, that are major importers of Iranian oil, going up to the Hill and saying, we're not going to lower our levels of oil, and in fact, if you guys walk away from the deal, we're going to start importing at regular rates again. That's pretty scary and it's pretty sobering. So I think there were a number of things that we were able to do in the public sphere that went a long way to convince people that even if you didn't want to talk about the science of the deal, you could see the argument about why this was in the interest of U.S. national security.
Thank you. Before I continue, I just want you all to know that we will be opening this up to Q&A. So I hope that you're all thinking of your questions because I will be talking the entire time, so just please keep that in mind. So I want to go back to this idea of engagement and the idea that military might does not always work, and in this situation we appear to see the success of that. What does this deal mean for diplomacy in the future, particularly with engaging nations that are not necessarily, or that we don't necessarily have the best history relationships?
So a very good question. I do think that this deal sends a very clear message to the world, and of course it's very new and we're not going to see the immediate impact, but that even the most contentious, controversial issues between two countries who share such a difficult history, who don't have had diplomatic relations for over 35 years, can be solved with diplomacy. And it kind of restores a bit of American leadership in that realm. Because while this was negotiated along with our partners and it's a multilateral arrangement, not something just between the US and Iran, it shows that that we are able to bilaterally engage with Iran and resolve some of these issues diplomatically. I think it sends a powerful message to the region. I mean, the region is right now going through various civil conflicts that ultimately can only be solved through political solutions. While this is not a direct parallel, it does send that same message that these difficult issues can be negotiated through hard-nosed diplomacy and commitment to a diplomatic process. Over 100 countries, in addition to our P5+1 and the EU partners, have come out in support of the deal. They've sent a very clear message to the international community that they support this type of approach for reducing tensions between countries. So, hopefully it sets it's a positive precedent going forward, perhaps for U.S.-Iran relations, we don't know, but more broadly, I think it sends a clear message to the international community that such a diplomatic breakthrough is possible.
I think one thing I would add to that is it's also important to remember that this was not just diplomacy and negotiations, right? You have to look at all the tools that were employed. You had sort of what Richard Haass and Megan O'Sullivan called in a great article they wrote, honey and vinegar, right? You had a blend of sort of punishing tools, that was the sanctions, which put Iran's economy under such crushing pressure that eventually, its leaders decided they had to come to the table to sort of be able to revive the country and keep the people somewhat happy. You also had sort of the honey part of it, which was incentives, right? So Iran, hopefully, understood that by engaging these negotiations, they would receive potential entree back into the international community, sort of the world of nations, as we've called it, that they would have investment opportunity. We've already seen the French Foreign Minister Fabius talking about business delegations heading to Tehran, that they would have more access to the international financial system, investment, ways to lift their people up out of sort of the decline that the sanctions have put on the economy. You also, very importantly, had the threat of military action, right? That's something that the president never took off the table and still hasn't taken off the table. So while he did not choose to employ military action as a tool, the specter of that was always hanging over the heads of the Iranians. So you had sort of a mix of incentives and punitive measures that I think created the perfect storm, put them under enough pressure that they recognized there's an opening. They tested the proposition in the secret talks, saw that the president was indeed very serious about these negotiations. We felt the same way during those secret talks, that they were serious. We didn't feel like this was a game, that they were using the talks, as Sahar said, potentially like the North Koreans did, as a way to advance their program while stalling the international community. And so I think it's a mix of looking at all the tools that are available to the practitioners of statecraft, diplomacy being the ultimate form that they took, but combining incentives, punitive measures, and a very serious threat of military action.
So just to play the role of devil's advocate for just a bit, critics, we
we hear from the critics a lot that how can you engage with, you know, Iran when we hear somewhat troubling statements still coming from the Ayatollah? How do you all respond to that that criticism as part of the talks?
Well, I think the president has actually, I feel like, answered this question the best, and so I'll probably kind of mirror his answer, is that, you know, as U.S. president, he's not going to engage in kind of tit for tat, depending on what, you know, comes out of a Twitter account associated with, you know, Ayatollah Khomeini. You know, we continue to condemn that rhetoric. Ultimately, what it comes down to is what's, you know, in the deal itself. This is only about the nuclear issue. I think that's clear on both sides, that both sides view this as a very compartmented issue. This is not about rapprochement. This doesn't mean we turn a blind eye to all the destabilizing activities that Iran is behind in the region. Because we don't turn a blind eye to human rights. These are things we're going to continue to be concerned about going forward. And so while the rhetoric is troubling, to say the least, what mattered to us was having a verifiable deal in hand that prevented Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapon, precisely because we are concerned, you know, sometimes based off just the rhetoric and some of the actions about the intentions of the regime.
I think it's also important to point out that, as Sahar said, the focus of this deal is strictly on the nuclear question. So you have hundreds of sanctions that remain in place on Iranian entities, Iranian actors, Qasem Soleimani, the IRGC, the Quds Force, these groups that are responsible for destabilizing actions in the broader region around the world. They remain sanctioned because those are sanctions that are not related to the nuclear issue. As Sahar said, there are also sanctions that will remain in place on people who engage in violations of human rights of the Iranian citizens. We are still actively involved in trying to figure out a resolution to the four Americans who are either detained or missing in Iran. All of those are concerns that weigh very heavily on our mind. We are not at all naive about the implications of those and what may happen in the future, but again, it's important to realize that this deal was focused on the nuclear question because ultimately the decision that the president made was, if you have a bad actor in the region, like Iran has been playing a bad actor role, if that bad actor has a nuclear weapon, that makes them infinitely more dangerous, difficult to deal with, volatile, and more of a threat to our allies, our partners in the region, in addition to our own national security. So if we could take that off of the table, it doesn't mean that the other issues go away, but it means that you're able to deal with them in a way that you couldn't if it was a nuclear power.
So this will be just my final question for now, we're just going to open it up for the audience. But turning to the audience, we are here at KU, we're young people, we are students. And the work is clearly not over. There's still a lot to do. What can young people do? What have young people been doing in terms of their support or pushing for the deal, whether it's calling their members of Congress or writing op-eds or letters to the editor? What kind of impact can young people make on these types of historic deals?
Well, I think you know, remaining engaged on issues that are important to you, whether it's, you know, the Iran nuclear deal or other issues, foreign policy issues that you feel passionate about. Either way, whether you're for or against, you know, what the current, you know, administration is doing, to just kind of be civically active, I think, is incredibly important. You know, at this stage, you know, obviously this was an incredibly intense debate over this deal. And so, you know, at the White House, we engaged with groups from all sides, you know, and heard arguments both for and against. And it was great to just see people, you know, very energized and taking this debate so seriously. So I'd encourage, you know, all of you who are kind of interested in doing the same to do so in the future.
So just as a quick follow-up to that, we do hear a lot also with the young crowd that, you know, political apathy is high sometimes, and my voice doesn't matter, and why should I even be engaged in such a high-level conversation? What's the kind of impact that you've seen take place from these kinds of conversations?
Sure. I mean, I think part of how the debate became so intense was the young people at all these various organizations, you know, again, on both sides. You know, I think everybody's voice does really count in these types of debates. And so, you know, I know that it's easy to just think, my opinion doesn't matter and, you know, this will be decided at higher levels. But really it starts kind of at that, I really do believe that it starts at that kind of grassroots level and trickles up.
I think in this case in particular, if you look at some of the statements released by some of the Democrats who crossed lines, there were very few, thankfully, but the statements that some of them released, they were very heartfelt. And what resonated in all of them for me was how they seemed very torn, right, between supporting sort of their leader, their party, sort of the ideals, the progressive values that they generally ascribe to, and ultimately making this decision not to support this deal. And if you look at what several of them offered as anecdotal evidence for why they made that determination, many of them cited town halls that they had when they went home to their constituencies, the number of phone calls that they received, the numbers of letters that they received, the numbers of petitions that they received, in those particular instances against the deal from constituencies who had very, you know, high opinions against the deal. But I think you saw the same thing for folks who voted for the deal, saying, you know, my office was flooded with, you know, X times the amount of calls on this issue than any other national security I can remember in recent history. So all of that came from grassroots levels, and I can remember when we first challenged an op-ed that was put out, this would have been a year and a half ago, and released a statement that sort of really intensified some of the debate on the Hill in particular. We saw groups that are not necessarily usually aligned with the White House position were like on fire. I mean, organizing petitions, robocalls into these different constituencies, not in the Washington offices, but back home, you know, where politicians sort of feel a little bit more of the heat in Washington. You can sort of go on CNN and be part of a debate, and you're a little distant from it, sort of the ivory tower. But when you go home and you're in an audience like this, and you're a congressman or you're a senator, and you're facing hundreds of people who are furious at you for your position, that gets under your skin and affects the way you vote, right? But if you go home and there's an empty auditorium and nobody's really making their views heard, you can sort of vote one way or the other and feel like, well, you don't have to really be accountable because nobody seems to care that much about the issue. And in this debate, we really heard that people were influenced either way, in support of or in opposition to the deal, because the grassroots movements really, really came out with all guns blazing on both sides of this issue, and it put a lot of pressure on the decision makers.
So I'd like to open it up now to the audience for Q&A. If you can just raise your hand and then I'll call on you, and if you could project, because we don't have mics floating around, but just so that our speakers can hear the question. If you can just raise your hand up high, and then also please announce your name and
my name is Kate Gould, and I'm with the Friends Committee on National Legislation, as is this front row. So we take it over, even though we're not GW students, but very happy to be here. And yeah, congratulations to you both, I mean, for your tireless work over these years to achieve one of the greatest diplomatic achievements of our time. So deserves a round of applause. So thank you for that, too. So I guess I'm interested in your thoughts about prospects for more congressional interference. So, of course, we hope that, as Bernadette mentioned, that we can go forward and come together in implementation. But now with reports about new legislation that can authorize the transfer of a bunker buster bomb to Israel, or we interpret the terms of the deal or other craziness, and also actually even support from some Democrats for an authorization to use military force against Iran, kind of how that affects the negotiations. So that was the comment. And then if I could just do a quick plug to the audience, also on the importance of grassroots advocacy. One thing that you can do today and tomorrow is to make one more call, because while the big vote had happened, there's going to be another vote tomorrow in the Senate at 6 o'clock. And so you can call 1-855-68-NO-WAR and be directed to your senator's office and urge them to vote in support of the deal. So,
I'll kind of field the legislation question initially. So I think we've kind of been through ups and downs with Congress in terms of, you know, the role that they could play to either be, you know, kind of helpful or unhelpful to the negotiations. I mean, we're confident in our ability to move forward with the implementation of the deal. I
think the president has made clear publicly on multiple occasions now that if Congress tries to pass a piece of legislation that prevents implementation of this deal, he will veto it. You know, the same kind of arguments apply to basically Congress voting down the deal and kind of losing our credibility internationally, and the sanctions regime crumbles. Iran, we've said, moves ahead with the advancing its nuclear program without any of the constraints of this deal. You know, et cetera, et cetera. All of those would still apply if Congress passes a new piece of legislation that then basically derails the deal that we've been able to achieve. So I think that will be our stance going forward. That said, you know, we're willing to kind of engage with Congress as we were, you know, before the deal was reached, and understand that they have a role to play. I mean, ultimately, it will be Congress that will eventually have to terminate sanctions on Iran if they comply with the deal over time. So, you know, we're going to continue to have, you know, compliance reports, you know, coordinate with them on, in terms of our regional strategy vis-a-vis Iran. So there's lots of space for us to have a constructive back and forth with Congress. But of course, things that cross over into those red lines where they're preventing implementation of this deal or derailing what was achieved, I think the president has made clear he will veto.
I think something interesting also that we saw after the JPOA and then the interim sort of comprehensive deal was, you know, lots of folks who had been throwing up their hands and saying, you know, this is like a mistake of the century and, you know, this is just like a disaster all around. When the deal was actually implemented, both, you know, the initial JPOA and then the comprehensive interim deal, people saw that Iran actually was complying with their commitments. It was an open process. There was open verification. The IAEA was able to go in and say, yes, Iran has diluted or converted its stockpile. It has, you know, met its commitments up at Arak. It's not doing additional nuclear-related construction, so on and so forth. So I think what got lost a little bit, you know, in this last debate with Congress is the fact that there have essentially been two live trial periods, right? This wasn't a deal that was done sort of in a vacuum and conceptually. I mean, Iran had for a year and a half complied with the initial terms of the deal. So the hope would be, now that sort of the initial, you know, spat with Congress is over, that Iran does in fact uphold its commitments, and that people sort of can take a step back and say, you know what, just like the JPOA ended up being okay, this is going to be okay. I mean, it was amazing to me to see how many people came out, both here and overseas, and said, why do we need to have a final deal? Why can't we just stick with the JPOA? That was really great. And I sort of scratched my head and said, weren't you the person that was like lighting themselves on fire on TV saying that that was going to be like the end of the world, and now you want that to be the permanent result? So hopefully once the rhetoric dies down, we will see people draw together, and again, to the point we made earlier, sort of focus on implementation of the deal verification and focusing on Iran's other malign activities in the region and dealing with those very serious problems.
Hi everyone, my name is Will Montania. Thank you both for all your great work that you've done. Thank you all for opening up this forum as well too. I wanted to ask you specifically in regards to some terminology that you're using as a basis for this. You said there was a cabinet of tools that you guys used and used the framework of vinegar and honey was the word you used. To avoid, utilizing diplomacy to avoid war. That's what we're all talking about. You guys have done a great job. What I wanted to ask though, because what's not covered, also secret like a lot of those Oman trips, was the utilization of cyber warfare, Sputnik specifically. It's been admitted through multiple secondary channels throughout Israeli government and the U.S. government that it was completely sponsored, nation-state sponsored. The result of Sputnik, which was designed specifically for Natanz, shut down Natanz, as you all know, I'm sure, is the result of a new cyber warfare, right? So we have the diplomacy on the superficial forefront. There's no cyber diplomacy. The result of this cyber warfare, the times were shut down, we came to our talking tables, and Iran didn't move. Why? The facilities were shut down. Of course, this was not spoken about much in the public, it wasn't spoken. But now it's coming at the forefront, still on a low degree, in the United States. Why? OPM is hacked. 20 million civil service people's identity is taken, even CIA members. And that is still talked about low. But they say, as a result, too, Iran has one of the strongest cyber armies now, too, directly as a result of Sputnik. So my question that I have for you all is, A, why was there no cyber diplomacy done, right? And number two, what is any contingency plans for the future of this new growing issue that's a completely ignored in public, which is the cyber war, issue of cyber warfare is blowing up.
So I will employ my spokesman hat here and say, sadly, which will be no surprise to you, allegations of Stuxnet or other related activities are not something that I can comment on or discuss. I will say that, you know, you're absolutely right that in looking at how we solve this problem, there are a number of tools that are employed. Increasingly, separate from the Iran negotiations, certainly cyber warfare is something that is a huge concern. It's a huge threat and challenge for the national security of the United States. Iran certainly is an active actor in that field, and someone with whom we are actively working to improve capabilities and try and counter those threats. There's not really much more, unfortunately, that I could discuss on that topic in this setting. I'll defer to Sahar if she has anything to add.
Nothing further.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Again, things are still pretty fresh. You know, we're open to kind of talking through kind of the next phase of our relationship now that kind of we're a bit through the almost all the way through the congressional review period. I think, you know, one example we can use to kind of maybe guide our thinking on this is when we reached the interim deal, the JPOA. I can't remember the exact quote, but Israel called it basically like a disaster, something along those lines. They were not happy with it.
A mistake of historic.
There you go.
Thank you.
And so, you know, they thought that, you know, Iran was going to use the cover of negotiations to expand this program. It was going to cheat. It was going to use all the sanctions really to support terrorism. It was going to do all these terrible things. And none of that actually ended up being true in the end. And so hopefully with this deal, you know, the onus is on Iran to comply with the deal and kind of prove to the international community that, you know, it can have a peaceful nuclear program. And over time, I do think that, you know, or at least I'm hopeful that the Israeli government will come around and realize that this truly is in its national security interests. But, you know, we understand Israel's concerns and, you know, if they don't, you know, we'll still manage to keep our ties close. But I think our hope is that as they saw, you know, the JPOA actually was a success, they will see that the JCPOA is also a success.
And I think there are a couple other things I would add to Sahar's lay down. One is it's important to recognize that throughout the entire process from the JPOA onward, we have been in close contact and collaboration with Israeli counterparts. We have an incredibly robust intelligence relationship with them, which is something you don't often hear about in the news, obviously, because intelligence isn't often spoken about. But intelligence estimates, all of those sorts of timelines about breakout, capabilities, things like that, are rigorously discussed with the Israelis. Obviously, on the diplomatic side, on the military side, all of that cooperation and coordination continue throughout the process and will continue. So I don't think you'll see any change to any of those things. I think the president, you know, came out and said at one point before all the congressional hoopla this summer and said, I want to make it very clear that none of these lines of coordination or cooperation are going to be diminished in any way, even though we're having what is, you know, a very uncomfortable public spat with the Israelis over this particular issue. In no way are we going to change any of the other support that we provide to them. You've also seen a lot about security assurances and those kinds of discussions. We've had them with Israel. We've had them, obviously, with members of the Gulf at the GCC summit in Camp David that the president convened. You will see no loss to Israel's QME, their qualitative military edge, the military equipment that we provide to them. And I think, as Sahar said, hopefully what you'll see now is sort of putting this aside a little bit and a sort of a reestablishment of the normalization of the rhetoric and that cooperation with Israel. The one other thing that's important to remember is, and we've tried to say this, although it's gotten lost, is, you know, Iran is a national security threat to the United States as well in its current incarnation. But we can never pretend, as much as we can try to understand the threat that Iran poses to Israel, you know, we can empathize, but we can't say we understand what it's like to be an Israeli living in Tel Aviv or living in Jerusalem or living in Haifa or in Sderot or any of these areas, because the fact is, you know, Israel lives in that neighborhood and we don't. So we can see what the threat is, but we can't personally say we understand, right? It would be disingenuous of us to do so. So I think it's important to continually highlight that we recognize the threat that Iran plays to Israel's security. We will do everything we can to protect Israel, both through assistance, security, and otherwise. And hopefully now that the rhetoric dies down, we can go back to sort of a normalization of what that relationship is.
So I think we have time for just a couple more questions. Hi, I'm Dan. I'm at GWC. Where do you see Iran-U.S. relations going from here? Do you see this as kind of like the beginning of a paradigm shift or a one-off?
The eight-ball question. Well, so where we are right now is, you know, we were able to resolve, you know, hopefully once the deal is implemented, the nuclear issue. You know, I think the president's made clear this is not rapprochement, this is not the normalization of diplomatic relations, but it is an important step. And I think it could potentially be a catalyst for, you know, engagement on other issues. We've always made clear that we're open to kind of Iran, serving a more constructive role in the region or being a constructive player at the table on regional issues. But these are things that really, it will just kind of take time, and we'll have to see what the Iranian side is willing to do. You know, I think on that side, there's not much readiness to have any further discussions with the United States. But if there is, I think, we can kind of assess that, whenever that time comes. But for now, I think, our assessment is that this could be a catalyst for Iran moving in a more moderate direction. Maybe not. This deal doesn't count on that. You know, it's completely independent of that. But I think we recognize that this could potentially be a catalyst for, at least reduced tensions between the United States and Iran over other issues in the future. But, personally, I hope that's the case, but we'll just have to see.
Hi, I'm Mahmoud, I'm a GW student. I'm in a nuclear policy class, and the question I was giving for a term paper is a bit pessimistic, so I don't want to end it off this note. But the question is basically, if Iran doesn't comply with the JCPOA, what's the next step? A lot of people are saying sanctions, like the snapback sanctions, are a good interim, but they won't be enough. I mean, if Iran violates it, the faith is lost almost, and it's like a non-starter kind of, like there's no point again. So what's the next step? Is it military? Is it anything else? I hope it doesn't happen, but if it does, what is it?
Well, I think the same way we've exhausted diplomacy right now to kind of reach the deal we just reached, I think, if there came a time where Iran's found in material breach of the deal, there are certain kind of dispute resolution mechanisms that are part of this deal. Because it is technical, there could be hiccups here and there, and so we kind of wanted a mechanism that we would have kind of a buffer before resorting to kind of more, extreme options. But yeah, if Iran decides, you know what, I'm going to get a nuclear weapon, I'm just going to break out, I'm going to kick out inspectors, all the options that remain to us today will be available to us in the future. That includes the range of tools that Bernadette laid out, including the military option. But of course, I think any president would feel the responsibility to fully exhaust diplomacy even in that scenario. And if it was exhausted, then they would use all the tools that they would have available to prevent Iran from getting a nuclear weapon.
I think one thing to add to that that is a benefit of this deal, and it applies even though the deal hasn't even really gone into effect yet because the JPOA is still in effect, is we will be much better prepared to respond, right? And that's one of the arguments that we've made is we have already seen Iran, reduce or convert its stockpile. It's taken steps to halt the progress already at Arak, at the plutonium reactor, several other steps that it's taken. So you've already seen them roll back a little bit of the program. And if they did, as Sahar said, in the absolute worst sort of doomsday scenario, say, okay, we're going to break out for a weapon, the idea is because we've already started these intrusive inspections, because they've had to turn over schematics, plans, other sorts of things to the IAEA and other agencies, we have better insight into the program, and that's only going to grow as the deal continues. So we have that already now, more than we did a year and a half ago, and with each year of the deal that goes by, we'll have more and more. So in the doomsday scenario, if they kick all of the inspectors out, we've had eyes on the program and we know more about it than we or the Israelis or anyone else would ever have known without the deal, which helps us respond in a better way. And if it ultimately came to military action,
you know, you'd be better prepared to launch a military attack in theory because you'd know more about the program, the facilities, where they're producing centrifuges, where they're mining uranium, converting it, producing rotors, things like that.
Thank you. We'll take one last question, and you will be it.
Hi, I'm a little stuffed up, so sorry if you can't hear me. But I'm Jordan. I'm from the American Enterprise Institute. And my question had to do with how much do you think Iran's willingness to engage with the U.S. in the P5+1 on the nuclear deal was the Rouhani administration and that center of power in the regime, and how much do you think it was the system as a whole? Because, for instance, last month, Ali Larijani claimed that there was repeated, insisted requests from the previous administration to enter negotiations with Iran, which Iran denied and waited until this administration that it was a decision by the system as a whole, right? But then you have, since the nuclear deal coming out, Rouhani and Zarif pushing for more moderate de-escalatory policies in Syria. They had like their little attempted conference with the Arab states next month. That's kind of, I don't know if it's going to happen. You probably know. I don't know. So how much of it do you think is Rouhani and that the centrists, the moderates, and how much of it is a real consensus?
So I guess, good question. There's no way to exactly pinpoint that. The one thing I will say is there's absolutely politics inside of Iran. And those politics have absolutely impacted this process along the way. And I do think, you know, there was certain internal dynamics involved in the Ahmadinejad administration, and I'm sure certain calculations at the time, you know, they made their decision that at the time they didn't want to engage as seriously. Some of those more moderate elements were not empowered during the Ahmadinejad administration. We saw them kind of come out of the woodwork again once Rouhani came in. And kind of how I pointed out earlier, there was, I mean, the folks who were on the negotiating team and had negotiated with the Ahmadinejad administration, negotiating team from Iran headed by the then SCNS Secretary Jalili, versus those the same folks who engaged with the current negotiating team described the differences like night and day in terms of seriousness. So I do think that they played kind of the Rouhani administration, you know, his negotiating team played a central role in this, but ultimately this was something that had to have consensus to reach this stage where we actually have an agreement. And so I think there were probably, you know, one can imagine the political debates that took place internally, you know, same way we have our own internal debates about what we should do about our national security priorities, same thing happens in Tehran. And ultimately, you know, in the end, Rouhani was able to kind of empower his team to achieve this deal. The Supreme Leader has made numerous statements in support of the negotiators. We've seen that kind of consistently throughout this process. So that to me, I mean, while there's no black and white answer that there's consensus across the board, because of course we have divisions inside of Iran, there's folks who are like just completely against this deal, same way we have opposition here, you have that in Tehran. And so, you know, it's a balance, and sometimes it tips in the favor of kind of a more moderate faction. And we'll see where they go from here in terms of they have parliamentary elections coming up in the spring. We'll see, you know, how that shakes out. But I do think that, you know, there was at least enough consensus to reach a deal.
And you saw just as, you know, their system in some ways mimicked ours in the sense that you saw their debates spill out publicly too. I mean, we issued a fact sheet at one point, and then Zarif came out and said that fact sheet's not true, and then the Iranian Majlis released like their own fact sheet, and like nobody understood what was in that fact sheet. So they had their own constituencies that they had to play to between hardliners, moderates, conservatives. And so some of that, you know, you wash out of the system. We would say things, or a reporter would come to me and say, did you see this fact sheet? Like, it says that they're, like, not removing any centrifuges. Is that true? And you'd say, like, look, we understand that they're going to say things and they're going to do things that are in response to the pressures within their own domestic system, the same way we have to do that. But at the end of the day, what matters is what the commitments are, what we can verify, you know, the steps that they're ultimately taking, which is the same way that they will judge us, not by sort of fact sheets and rhetoric, but are we complying with the actual terms of the agreement?
Thank you. Well, thank you both so much for being here tonight. I want to echo Kate's sentiments in congratulating the two of you on, I know that the journey was not that easy, and there is still work ahead. And just like Kate said, there is going to be another vote tomorrow, so remember.
It's 1-855-68-NO-WAR. You can put it in yourself. cell phone now. Make sure you call 1-855-68-NO-WAR.
Right. And like Sahar mentioned, it is so important to remain civically and politically engaged and active, and your voice does matter and it does count. So I do encourage you all to continue to remain engaged. And please join me in thanking Sahar and Bernadette for being here.